Running and Growing a Business QuickStart Guide. The Simplified Beginner's Guide to Becoming an Effective Leader, Developing Scalable Systems, and Profitably Growing Your Business. Written by Ken Colwell, PhD, MBA. Narrated by Dru Steeby. Copyright 2022 by Clydebank Media, LLC. Production copyright 2022 by Clydebank Media, LLC. Introduction. Anyone interested in reading about how to run and grow their business will find plenty of content out there offering advice, tips, or narratives about the best ways to do it. Some of this material is good, some of it is trite, and some of it is downright awful. So, if I'm asking you to read my stuff, the obvious questions are, why should you? What sets me apart from any number of other would-be experts? Before we get to the real meat of this quick start guide, let me tell you a little bit about my background and why I think my unique perspective will help you navigate complex issues more easily than you could on your own, or by turning to the myriad blog posts, newsletters, podcasts, etc. that deal with these topics. A few years ago, I was approached by the publishers of the Quick Start Guides to write about starting a business. I did, and to my gratification, Starting a Business Quick Start Guide became an immediate bestseller. Running and Growing a Business Quick Start Guide is my follow-up, reflecting the next significant hurdle for a founder after a successful launch. I believe my book succeeded due to both my experience in academia and my fluency in the practical nuts and bolts aspect of entrepreneurship. This combination allows me to use relevant, real-world examples to illustrate tried-and-true models from the domains of operations, human resources, and strategic management, in addition to entrepreneurship. Hopefully, this will demystify these concepts for you. I also don't pull any punches and am very blunt about what works and about the mistakes I've seen founders make over the years. My hope is that this will make for an enjoyable and educational read. I also write for readers who did not start out as entrepreneurs, as I didn't myself. I'm a Gen Xer. My dad was a corporate wage slave, and I assumed I would be too. So when I graduated from university, I started working in a series of normal jobs in finance. I ended up as a managing director at a major brokerage firm in San Francisco and also acquired, sorry Elon, an MBA. But I wasn't in San Francisco at just any time. I was there in the mid to late 1990s. In other words, during the dot-com boom and bust. It was the first time I'd been exposed to the startup world, and I was at ground zero. My company wasn't a startup, but we were making a major push into online brokerage and disrupting the relatively sleepy world of personal finance while basically inventing high-volume e-commerce as we went along. The whole firm experience left me burned out. I was tired of the middle manager's life of going to meeting after meeting, trying to get support and resources for the things I wanted to do. I wanted a way out, but I still wasn't thinking of starting my own business. In those days, tech deals needed massive amounts of capital to scale, which venture capital, VC firms, and other private equity organizations were happy to provide to the right people. I didn't have the technical background or expertise. It wasn't for me. Several of my MBA professors had suggested academia as a career path, so I started to ask more questions about it. It sounded awesome. Freedom to pursue whatever research projects I wanted, tenure for job security, and a good salary to boot. So I went to the University of Oregon to get my PhD in strategic management and entrepreneurship. As I was studying and observing the dot-com bubble in real time, my advisor and I realized that private equity, PE investors, were pivoting. They had been roasted in the press for their extravagant bets on what seemed to be worthless e-commerce plays. I remember, in particular, people laughing about VC funding for 5 online pet stores. Who in the world would buy pet kibble online? I write this as I await my latest Chewy order. On the other hand, when Pets.com was buying sock puppet ads for the Super Bowl, we all probably should have predicted that the bubble would burst. Once I got my PhD, I joined the faculty of Drexel University in Philadelphia as an assistant professor of strategy and entrepreneurship. At a school like Drexel, a professor's job is to produce high-quality research and teach a few courses each term. After a while, I found that I hated the research part of the job. I was too practical and impatient with the long time it took to get published and the politics it took to get into the best journals. I found myself drifting toward work at the Entrepreneurship Center, helping students who are interested in starting businesses and taking student teams to national business plan competitions. Even though we were well into the internet age, it still took a lot of money to begin and scale a tech startup, and budding entrepreneurs needed business plans with extensive details to pitch to potential investors. Because I wasn't enthusiastic about the major part of my job, academic research, I knew I had to find a new gig. By this time, I had acquired a decade of experience in the startup ecosystem. I'd met a lot of entrepreneurs, and I began to understand what made them tick and what deals were fundable and workable. With my foot already in the academic door, I got a job running the entrepreneurship program at the University of Miami School of Business. Freed of research responsibilities, I could focus on what I really loved, tapping into the local entrepreneur ecosystem and getting my students involved in it. Tapping into that ecosystem was also very educational for me. It was the first time I had really interacted with entrepreneurs on a personal basis, rather than as research subjects. I began to better understand how they thought and what motivated them. Because I was trained as a business researcher, I was able to recognize and characterize behaviors that led to successful outcomes in a way that was different from those without this background. I was also able to apply standard tools of strategic management, like external analysis of the firm environment and internal analysis of firm competencies and capabilities, to the entrepreneurial context and show how they were meant to be used to help managers make more effective decisions. As you will see over and over in this book, these tools can help you understand not only what needs to be done, but why. This realization led me to run an entrepreneurial consulting program with my students, helping local entrepreneurs, and eventually to found my own consulting firm, Innovative Growth Advisors. After a few years at UMiami, I felt I was ready for my next challenge in academic administration, so I became a dean. People misunderstand what a dean does, and those misperceptions aren't helped by depictions of deans in movies as evil despots out to foil students' fun. In reality, they are unit managers for fairly large organizational entities, managing academic programs with, in my case anyway, thousands of students and millions of dollars in annual revenue. I have been dean of business schools at three universities as of this writing, and I've tried to take the lessons of entrepreneurship and apply them to academia. In other words, to use the tools of creativity and innovation to attract new students and to help existing ones graduate and get good jobs. During these 20-plus years, I've been both an observer and a participant in the startup ecosystem in many ways, studying it as an academic, teaching it to students, acting as a consultant to help students and others start and grow their own business, and running my own ventures. This varied background has provided me with insight into what works and what does not. My perspective on business growth and success is very much my own and quite distinct from that of others who currently write, speak, think, and publish in this field. Speaking of 20-plus years of close observation, I've seen radical changes in the startup world over the last two decades. Gone are the days when you needed to raise millions of dollars and live in San Francisco or one of the other entrepreneurial hotspots. You can live wherever you like and start a business on your phone, sitting in your local coffee shop. There are apps to resolve every startup headache: supply chain issues, finding vendors and employees, payments, accounting, everything. And your venture doesn't have to involve big tech or big science to scale. It has never been easier to start a business. But in the end, you'll still have to deal with some very fundamental issues if your business is going to succeed. That's where this book comes in. It addresses the critical topics of personal health, management style, organizational design, and strategic management at three levels of analysis: the individual founder, you, the organization, your business, and your strategic context, the economic environment. That may seem a bit daunting, but don't worry, I've provided numerous real-world examples of companies, many which you've heard of, dealing with these issues. It is my sincere hope and objective that the perspectives gained and refined through your reading of this book will lead to successful outcomes for both your business venture and your general well-being. Good luck on the journey. One note on terminology. Growing and scaling are technically two different concepts, though they are similar and I treat them as such. Growth refers to any incremental revenue increase, and scaling is a specific type of growth in which revenue increases more rapidly than costs. Scaling is often the goal of company founders and brings with it a unique set of challenges because organizational complexity increases very rapidly with scaling. This book addresses the challenges of scaling, but the ideas and techniques I discuss work no matter what level of growth you seek. So I use the terms growing and scaling somewhat interchangeably throughout the text, because while that distinction does exist between the two terms, the general concepts surrounding them have the same basic relevance to your business. Chapter by chapter. This book is divided into three parts. Getting yourself ready for growth, part one, maneuvering for growth, part two, and strategic issues in growing your business, part three. You may be tempted to skip over the material in part one to get to the more nuts and bolts stuff in parts two and three. Resist that temptation. If you're going to truly scale your business, you need to look at yourself with the same scrutiny you apply to your business. So, before diving into the strategic and operational issues required for rapid expansion, you need to ask a personal and potentially uncomfortable question. Am I ready for this? In Chapter 1, Reflecting, I'll help you look in the mirror to find the answer. We'll examine how mindsets that fuel personal growth, such as curiosity and accountability, are essential to support your company's growth. I'll also share ways you can develop these mindsets. Continuing the emphasis on your foundational role, Chapter 2, Balancing, explores the link between your health and your company's health. I'll show you ways to preserve your mental and physical well-being as you grapple with growth. Rapid expansion creates plenty of upheaval, and this chapter will provide a path to balance. Personal development is also central to Chapter 3, Laughing, which reveals how lessons from the world of comedy can help you think in more flexible ways. Stress management amid business challenges is part of that. But as you'll see, the tools of comedy trade can also enhance your ability to effectively communicate, collaborate, and find creative solutions for complex problems. Part 2 kicks off with Chapter 4, Leading, where we'll build on the earlier exploration of great leader characteristics and look at facets of leadership that affect a firm's growth. You'll learn how aspects of leadership, such as delegation and transparency, will shape your ability to create and execute a compelling vision for your company. Leadership earned its own chapter, but it's not the only management ability you'll need to transform your business. We examine other essentials for your manager's toolkit in Chapter 5, Management Skills That Accelerate Growth. That includes strong communication skills and an organizational structure that fosters agility. You're not flying solo as a leader. You have a team to support you, and that team will need to expand significantly to drive your business goals. That's why Chapter 6, Hiring, is devoted to finding people who can fuel your growth. Your ability to recruit and keep valuable employees will help determine your company's fate. The people in your organization matter a great deal for your growth. So do operational tools, especially the ones that don't exactly sound sexy, like policies and procedures. But these are exactly the kind of tools that will help your business reach exciting heights. In Chapter 7, Create Scalable Systems and Processes, we'll learn why that's the case as we look at the importance of documentation that helps you respond quickly and gives you the ability to track performance closely while measuring what's meaningful. After exploring the ways you and your organization must be equipped for rapid growth, our discussion shifts in Part 3 to address strategies for pursuing that goal. In Chapter 8, Growing and Scaling, we'll examine approaches such as expanding existing product lines, exploring new product categories, and making acquisitions. Any form of expansion requires careful assessment because a painful gap exists between can and should. While it's great to have ideas for how to grow your business, you need to create something more concrete. You'll need a plan that allows you to execute your strategy. Chapter 9, Planning, is all about helping you develop a strategic plan that's flexible and guided by a well-crafted mission, with relevant goals that let you monitor progress. The best-laid business plans will languish if they lack enough money. To help you avoid that problem, we look at an array of funding sources in Chapter 10, Funding. These options for debt and equity are a critical step on the path to growth, because investments from friends and family won't be sufficient to support your new phase. Unpredictable events can destroy much, or all, of your hard-earned growth if you don't have strategies in place to respond. That's why I added a coda titled, We Live in a VUCA World. The acronym stands for Volatility, Uncertainty, Complexity, and Ambiguity. These things often require abrupt changes, and you'll find guidance here for making effective decisions when the stakes are high. You'll also see how the unofficial U.S. Marine Corps mantra applies to navigating chaos and protecting the health of your company. Part 1. Getting yourself ready for growth.
Chapter 1. Reflecting. Chapter Overview. Growth Mindset. Persistence. Accountability. Quote, success is not an accident. Success is actually a choice. Steph Curry. When speaking to people who are interested in starting a business, I find that they often have one of two distinctly different thought processes about learning entrepreneurial skills through training or mentoring. On one hand, many people think that it's unnecessary because entrepreneurs are born, not made. These people often have a fixed idea of what successful entrepreneurs look and act like, and they don't believe they have what it takes. On the other hand, a good percentage of nascent entrepreneurs also think training and mentoring is a waste of time for them, but it's because they already know everything there is to know and don't need to learn anything else in order to be successful. In my view, both of these types of people are inhibiting fixed mindsets. They both think they have an innate set of skills and abilities that can't be changed very much. They're both wrong. This chapter is about avoiding a fixed mindset and focusing on a growth mindset instead. The growth mindset. When you picture yourself, you may imagine a set of physical characteristics like height, weight, hair and eye color, etc., alongside a set of mental characteristics, personality, intelligence, skills, and abilities. As people move into adulthood, they tend to think these qualities are fixed. This leads many to having self-limiting beliefs. No matter what I do, I can never lose weight. I guess it's just my metabolism. Or how about, I'm not one of those techie types. I could never start an e-commerce business. And yet, we all know people who have experienced very positive physical transformations or learned new skills that helped them in their lives and careers. Are these people just part of the lucky few? Or can anyone improve their natural skills and abilities beyond whatever innate limitations they may have? According to Stanford University psychologist Carl Dweck, your answer to that question has profound implications for your life, because it determines what you accomplish. In her book, Mindset, Dweck explores this idea in detail. Grounded in more than 20 years of research, her work emphasizes the role of two different mindsets, fixed and growth, and their extensive power to shape our lives. 1. A fixed mindset stems from the belief that your qualities are carved in stone. It is a mindset that drives people to prove themselves repeatedly. Dweck has observed many people who are consumed by the desire to prove themselves in their careers and relationships. In every situation, they feel compelled to reaffirm something about their intelligence, personality, or character. As Dweck notes, when people with fixed mindsets encounter challenges, they ask questions focused on personal validation. Will I succeed or fail? Will I look smart or stupid? Will I be accepted or rejected? Will I feel like a winner or a loser? 2. A growth mindset comes from the belief that your qualities can be enhanced through focused, sustained effort. This doesn't mean people with a growth mindset believe that everything and anything is possible. They don't expect to will themselves into becoming the next Einstein or Michael Jordan. Rather, they believe their true potential is unknown, because it's not possible to predict exactly what years of dedicated effort will yield. In the words of William Shakespeare, we know what we are, but not what we may be. Unlike with a fixed mindset, the desire to learn eclipses the need for approval. People with a growth mindset reframe mistakes and failures. They don't feel anxious because they're afraid they might look stupid. Instead, challenging situations spark their enthusiasm and willingness to improve by practicing new skills and seeking new information. These mindsets have particular relevance for entrepreneurs focused on expansion. That's because in business, as in life, the only constant is change. To navigate the ever-shifting terrain of industry trends, customer needs, and the economy, you'll need to develop new skills and improve existing ones. Your company won't be able to adapt, a topic we'll further explore in Chapter 11, unless you have a growth mindset. One essential quality of a growth mindset is persistence, which we'll cover in more detail later in this chapter. As the leader of a growing company, you will find yourself repeatedly stretched to the limit. By cultivating a growth mindset, entrepreneurs do more than endure challenging times. They find ways to thrive and use their passion as fuel during a struggle. Example: how the fixed mindset of CEO disease will keep you in the dark. When company leaders have an overwhelming need to feel smart, they often end up with CEO disease. They insulate themselves from honest feedback. Travis Kalanick, the founder of Uber, who was forced to resign as CEO in 2017, provided a memorable demonstration of this, thanks to a dash cam that recorded him arguing with an Uber driver. When the driver complained that he'd lost nearly $100,000 due to Uber's lowering of rates, Kalanick lost his temper. Before storming out of the vehicle, he told the Uber driver, "Some people don't like to take responsibility for their own shit. They blame everything in their life on somebody else. Good luck." Instead of listening with an open mind and genuine interest in how the company's decisions affected the lives of its frontline workers, Kalanick lashed out when his leadership was criticized. If you want to see a cure for CEO disease in action, look to Fadi Gondour, the co-founder of the Dubai-based delivery and logistics firm, Aramex. When Gondour arrived in Dubai at 2 a.m. after a trip, he stepped outside the CEO cocoon. Instead of using a luxury car service, he had one of his company's package couriers pick him up at the airport and drive him to his hotel. He used that time to ask the courier detailed questions about his work. As he listened closely, Gondour discovered that operational issues hindered the courier's ability to make on-time deliveries. He immediately scheduled an all-hands meeting of local management. Gondour ensured that several couriers also attended so he could ask them questions and allow the managers to hear their descriptions of ongoing work problems. The tone of the meeting was just as important as the content. The CEO didn't call out managers and blame them for overlooking problems. Instead, the meeting focused on gathering information and learning. The experience compelled Gondour to create a new company policy. All executives must occasionally work as couriers so they can detect problems early by appreciating the challenges faced by frontline workers. Think for a moment about these two CEO examples, Travis Kalanick at Uber and Fadi Gondour at Aramex. Consider which one reflects your mindset when you're faced with criticism. As a leader, what's your capacity for listening to complaints and learning from them? Your initial feeling might be defensiveness, and that's okay, as long as you don't let that feeling control your next move. Instead of a knee-jerk reaction, jerk being the operative word here, you can choose to pause for a moment and respond to criticism with a sense of curiosity. Cultivating the growth mindset. The real difference between a fixed mindset and a growth mindset is how much control you believe you have over your own future. People with fixed mindsets believe their future is something that happens to them, and they just have to cope with whatever comes up around the bend. People with a growth mindset believe their future is something they can create. That may seem like a minor difference, but it leads to a profound difference in how you live your life and approach difficult situations. Here's the good news. Although one mindset often dominates much of our behavior, we are all a mix of both. And Dweck outlines the steps we can take to shift the balance toward a growth mindset. Start by accepting that we all have a combination of fixed and growth mindsets. Learn to recognize what triggers your fixed mindset. This could be failure, criticism, deadlines, or disagreements. What are the events or situations that make you feel your abilities are fixed, and as Dweck says, transport you to a place of judgment rather than a place of development? Understand what happens after the arrival of your fixed mindset persona, meaning the inner voice that urges you to avoid challenges and ruthlessly criticizes when you fail at something. This could mean giving your fixed mindset persona a name, such as a person in your life, a character in a book or a movie, or just a name you don't like, to remind yourself that that's not who you want to be. Think how this persona influences the way you think, feel, and act. How does that affect you and the people around you? As you become more familiar with your fixed mindset persona, don't judge it. Instead, focus on observing it. Recognize that your fixed mindset persona was created to keep you safe. That's why it fears uncertainty and also why it will limit what you can accomplish. Instead of trying to block that fixed mindset inner voice, note when it shows up. Explore what it's saying. Don't try to silence it immediately, because that will just make it stick around longer. Allow your mind to settle down a little bit. Then, respond to the inner voice by reflecting on the changes you'll make based on whatever setback you just experienced. With this approach, you can slowly teach your fixed mindset persona to think in a different way. Failure is not a permanent condition, unless you fail to believe you have the capacity to change. We can't eliminate our fixed mindset triggers entirely. Instead, the goal is to gradually learn to remain in a growth mindset place despite the inevitable triggers. And recognizing that everyone struggles with a fixed mindset persona in their daily lives can strengthen the compassion we feel for others. It might sound small, but this is a quality that can really help your teams thrive. A growth mindset helps create conditions for success. Example. In 2020, payment processing company Fat Merchant was on Inc.'s 5,000 list for the second year in a row, with more than 1,000% growth. Here's what makes that remarkable achievement even more notable. 10 years earlier, founder and CEO Sunira Madandi had no interest in starting a company. Because her father was an entrepreneur, she saw firsthand how unpredictable that path could be. But she recognized a widespread customer need. She wanted to change the perception that payment processors are a necessary evil by offering customers a flat fee on top of the credit card interchange rate and a monthly subscription so they wouldn't be trapped in long-term contracts. She envisioned technology that would bring all the customers' transactions, whether online, in-store, or mobile, onto one platform and provide data analytics to help improve business performance. A year after she founded her company in 2014, Madhandi joined a tech accelerator in Orlando to help develop the technology needed to bring all customer transactions into one platform and ultimately integrate that platform with other applications, such as QuickBooks. By 2018, her company had reached $10.3 million in annual revenue. Madhandi's growth mindset played a critical role in transforming her clear vision into an entrepreneurial reality. "I didn't go to CEO school, but I always know how to raise my hand and ask for help, and I know how to get the right resources together," she told Middle Market Growth magazine. "That has probably been my biggest reason for my personal success." Other important mindsets. A growth mindset isn't the only essential attribute shared by successful entrepreneurs. To facilitate your growth as a leader, you must also cultivate curiosity, optimism, and self-awareness. All three of these relate to the growth mindset development process because they reflect the power of continuous learning. Curiosity will keep you constantly seeking new ideas and perspectives. Optimism allows you to see opportunities in challenging situations and find the motivation to take calculated risks. Self-awareness helps you to thoroughly assess personal strengths and weaknesses, identifying areas for improvement you never knew existed. Let's look at each of these mindsets in detail to better understand how they can affect your business performance. Optimism. Quote, "I have not failed. I have just found 10,000 ways that won't work." Thomas Edison. When entrepreneurs thrive during tough times, they're often drawing strength from another powerful mindset, optimism. Optimistic business leaders increase their chances of success by refusing to dwell on setbacks. Instead, they see mistakes as opportunities to learn and building blocks for growth. It's a source of fortitude that can help you overcome daunting challenges. Having this attitude helps you recognize the lack of success in the moment isn't the same thing as failure in the long term. Let's face it. You had to have some optimism when you started your business in the first place. You knew perfectly well that most new businesses fail, so the odds were not in your favor. But you believed that some combination of factors, your killer product, your solid plan, your dogged determination, etc., were going to lead you to beat those odds. And you were right. As Henry Ford once said, whether you think you can or think you can't, you're right. Optimism doesn't mean sitting back and believing everything will be fine. That's not optimism. That's denial. Rather, it means believing in yourself and your team, which is why our explanation of hiring practices in Chapter 6 is so critical. Optimism is a reflection of faith in your ability to problem solve and make choices that strengthen your brand's reputation and integrity. Your business challenges won't disappear just because you have optimism, but they won't feel quite so insurmountable. Optimism is also essential for grit, a quality we'll examine a little later. Although many entrepreneurs aspire to be disruptors, few deserve that title as much as Henry Ford. He revolutionized an entire industry. But there's something most people don't know about his historic disruption. The biggest stepstones to the Ford Motor Company came in the form of two huge business failures. Ford moved beyond his entrepreneurial disasters by not treating them as disasters. In that regard, optimism played a significant role. Ford didn't believe things would magically work out. Instead, he trusted his ability to learn and solve problems. In his book, Mastery, author Robert Greene describes Ford's not-so-successful foray into auto manufacturing and how it shaped his ultimate success. In the late 1890s, Ford founded the Detroit Automobile Company, with funding from a prominent Detroit businessman. High hopes were soon replaced with a constellation of setbacks. Ford's prototype car had to be reworked, and some parts were too heavy or of poor quality. As Ford refined his design, stockholders grew impatient. A year and a half after the company launched, the board of directors dissolved it. From this failure, Ford concluded that his auto design had tried to address too many consumer needs. His next car would be smaller and lightweight. Ford's Detroit investor gave him a second chance with this approach, and they formed the Henry Ford Company. But Ford soon felt pressured to get his design into production quickly. As he tried to set higher standards for the industry, he became increasingly frustrated with business people who lacked design knowledge and yet continued to interfere with his process. Ford left the company less than a year after it was founded. Industry observers had no doubt that Ford's auto manufacturing days were over. With so much money at risk, second chances in the industry rarely happened, and a third chance was out of the question. But Ford seemed blithely unconcerned, writes Green. He told everyone that these were all invaluable lessons to him. He had paid attention to every glitch along the way, and like a watch or an engine, he had taken apart these failures in his mind and had identified the root cause. No one was giving him enough time to work out the bugs. As Ford saw it, the investors kept mucking up his clear vision of the process. Instead of allowing him to perfect his design, they kept offering mediocre ideas in areas they didn't understand. In addition to optimism, Ford also had luck. He managed to find a like-minded investor who agreed to stay out of the production process of Ford's new business, the Ford Motor Company. By focusing his efforts on how to do better next time, Ford remained undaunted in the face of failure. As Green writes in Mastery, "It's a curse to have a flawless first attempt. You will fail to question the element of luck, making you think that you have the golden touch. When you do inevitably fail, it will confuse and demoralize you past the point of learning." As your company experiences growing pains, you will need to inspire others during difficult times, and optimism can have a powerful effect. Winston Churchill understood this well. Throughout World War II, Churchill delivered speeches filled with the painful reality Britain faced, and then followed those sobering facts with words of optimism, explaining why he expected the nation would prevail. It's crucial to note, however, that Churchill did include these sobering, painful realities before unleashing his optimistic reassurances. So a word of caution here. Too much optimism can be a problem, especially for someone running a business. Being overly optimistic can lead you to be too aggressive and take too many risks because you believe they'll pay off no matter what. It can also lead you to continue to follow unfruitful paths with the confidence that things will turn around anytime now. This impulse is often driven by the sunk cost fallacy, defined as our reluctance to abandon a course of action because we've already invested heavily in it, whether that's time, effort, money, or all of the above. The longer we hold on to a belief, the harder it becomes to admit we're wrong. That's why entrepreneurs need to maintain an open mind and continually interrogate their opinions. Otherwise, the sunk cost fallacy will compel them to stick with a plan that no longer serves their business. This is where self-awareness comes in. If you know that optimism is one of your blind spots, you need to take steps such as those outlined in the self-awareness section to ensure that this positive mindset does not turn into a negative for you. Curiosity. Quote, "Research is formalized curiosity. It is poking and prying with a purpose." Zora Neale Hurston. No matter how smart you are today, much of your knowledge could be obsolete by next year. Technological innovation and changes to other aspects of your business environment, the economy, geopolitical upheavals, supply chain disruptions, shift in customer taste, or any number of other things, could require abrupt changes in the way you conduct business. That's why many of the greatest entrepreneurs are also relentlessly curious. They understand that if they don't continue to learn, they put their business at a disadvantage. When asked to name a trait that would help most CEOs succeed, Dell CEO Michael Dell responded, "I would place my bet on curiosity." If you aren't continually seeking new information and perspectives, it will hinder your company's ability to evolve by distancing you from the people who determine your success, namely your employees and your customers. Peter Drucker, one of the most influential management thinkers of all time, emphasized the need for curiosity throughout his career. In particular, he underscored the critical importance of having a curious mind that reflects carefully on what to ask. As Drucker wrote, "The important and difficult job is never to find the right answers. It is to find the right question. For there are few things as useless, if not dangerous, as the right answer to the wrong question." This includes the uncomfortable territory of questioning the beliefs you already have and how you might be wrong about them. Accepting that you will be wrong about many business decisions is a fundamental aspect of accountability, a topic we'll discuss later in this chapter. We often spend too much energy proving we're right and not enough being curious about whether we've led ourselves astray. By not clinging so tightly to the desire to be correct, we can remain curious about how our assumptions might be incorrect. As a result, we improve our ability to stay ahead of business threats, and we adapt more quickly when they emerge. Example:
The founder of IKEA, Ingvar Kamprad, excelled at staying relevant by being relentlessly curious about his customers. Kamprad wanted to stay in touch with the next generation of buyers. So when he was in his 70s, he continued to organize and attend conferences for teens. To remain connected with the consumers he served, he preferred to fly economy, even though he was one of the richest people in the world. He also preferred to take public transportation. "I see my task as serving the majority of people," he once said in an interview. The question is, how do you find out what they want and how best to serve them? My answer is to stay close to ordinary people because at heart, I am one of them. I don't think it's coincidental that so many top entrepreneurs are lifelong learners and voracious readers. Important. One common blind spot for business leaders, and everyone else for that matter, is how emotions influence decisions. Dan Ariely, MIT professor of behavioral economics and author of Predictably Irrational, observes that we consistently underestimate the role emotions play in our choices. Think we assume or believe that we are rational, but we're not. The interesting thing about irrationality is that it works on us in ways that we don't recognize, he said in an interview. It is the mistake that we repeatedly make as individuals. Ariely points out how odd and problematic it is for people to assume they have the capacity to always think rationally. Where is this assumption coming from? When we look at our physical existence, we don't assume that we can jump tall buildings and lift everything, says Ariely. We're realistic because we have a physical reality, and we realize what we can do and can't do. But when it comes to our minds, we assume that we're intellectual supermen. And that's a very strange and dangerous idea. In Chapter 6, we'll talk about the importance of having a board of advisors. Ariely's findings reinforce how essential that is for evaluating decisions, because as smart as you are, you're not as rational as you think. Hire an executive coach. You may think, I've been running my company just fine for years. I don't need a coach. If so, you're in good company, because that's the same reaction Google CEO Eric Schmidt had in 2002, when a board member and venture capitalist John Doerr told him, "You need a coach." After Schmidt questioned how that could possibly help an established CEO, Doerr replied that in his experience, everyone could use a coach. Schmidt ended up working with Bill Campbell, an ex-football coach who used his skills to coach a long list of tech leaders, including Steve Jobs at Apple, John Donahoe at eBay, Dick Costello at Twitter, and Sheryl Sandberg at Facebook. Schmidt became so convinced of Campbell's value as an executive coach that he even co-authored a book about his management lessons called Trillion Dollar Coach, the Leadership Playbook of Silicon Valley's Bill Campbell. Schmidt is one of many leaders who have discovered that an executive coach can help to reveal a common blind spot, namely, that we are pretty bad at seeing ourselves as others see us. The right coach will identify behaviors that are undermining your hard work. You'll have a guide to help you learn from constructive criticism instead of reacting defensively or falling into the pit of self-flagellation. Important. Want to know one of the biggest mistakes clients make when working with an executive coach? Here's what Marshall Goldsmith, one of the most respected executive coaches, has to say about that. He says it stems from a misguided expectation. The clients who expect that it's the coach's responsibility to make them change. As Goldsmith explains, that's not the coach's job. It's yours. Too many people think that a celebrity coach will solve their problems, Goldsmith told Harvard Business Review. That's like thinking you'll get in shape if you have the world's best personal trainer. A good trainer will help, obviously, but in the end, the only way you'll get in shape is if you work out. I think it was Arnold Schwarzenegger who said, "Nobody got muscles by watching me lift weights." Learn from the people around you. Even without a 360-degree review, you can still draw fodder for self-reflection from those around you. This approach is emphasized by Goldsmith, who considers himself a facilitator. He says that most of what his clients learn come from colleagues, friends, and family.
What I generally teach people is, the real coach isn't me. It's the people around you, Goldsmith says. If you want to have a better relationship with your customers, who needs to be your coach? Your customers. If you want to have a better relationship with your coworkers, who needs to be the coach? Your coworkers. If you want to develop a specific skill, listening, for example, Goldsmith has this advice. Don't ask a coach to explain how to be a great listener. Instead, ask the people around you this question. What are some ways I can do a better job of listening to you? The result, says Goldsmith, will be specific, concrete ideas that relate to communicating with those individuals. Instead of receiving generic communication tips from a coach, you'll understand how the people in your life perceive you as a listener, says Goldsmith. Even though they're not experts on the topic of listening, they actually know more about how you listen, or don't, than you do, or certainly than a coach does. Important. A candid assessment of personal flaws can give you more patience as a company leader. You'll have more tolerance for the shortcomings of others when you have more awareness of your own. Give credit to luck. If you become a wildly successful entrepreneur, remember this. There will always be people who are smarter than you or work harder, but don't make it. Luck always plays a role. It is an uncomfortable truth that some entrepreneurs have trouble admitting. The influence of luck comes up regularly on How I Built This, the popular podcast about successful entrepreneurs. The host, Guy Raz, ends every episode by asking entrepreneurs how much luck played a role in their success, compared to work, skill, or intelligence. Raz has said he asks this question not because he believes there's a right or wrong answer, but because it forces the entrepreneur to take a moment to reflect. When Raz asked it of Rod Cannon, father of Compaq Computer, the entrepreneur paused and shared a particularly self-aware response. Quote, "If you'd asked me that in the late 80s, I would have probably said it was 90% intelligence and insight and work, and 10% luck. But I would say today it was the other way around." That tells you how perspective changes with time. Rod Canyon, founder of Compaq Computer. My take. When I was an entrepreneurship professor, every time an entrepreneur visited my university to speak with my students, I always asked how luck played a role in their success. Here's what I discovered. The least self-aware entrepreneurs are the ones who can't identify a single way that luck played a role. There are even trite sayings about it that come up again and again. Luck is where preparation meets opportunity, or how about, the harder I work, the luckier I get. If you find yourself saying or even thinking these things, then you should take a step back and reevaluate. You've had much more luck in your life than you realize. Recognize blind spots. To truly develop self-awareness, we must accept that no matter how thoroughly we analyze our strengths and weaknesses, blind spots will always exist. One entrepreneur who understands this well is Rand Fishkin. His book, Lost and Founder, A Painfully Honest Field Guide to the Startup World, even has a chapter called Self-Awareness is a Superpower. Fishkin grew his company Moz to $45 million in annual revenue. He also worked with a therapist and executive coach after struggling with depression for years and finally seeking help. We'll examine the importance of protecting your mental health in Chapter 2. Through his executive coach, Jerry Colonna, Fishkin learned significant lessons about self-awareness. First and foremost, writes Fishkin, no one is self-aware, and equally, no founder is fully self-aware. If you believe you've achieved absolute self-awareness, that in itself is a blind spot. The goal is to maximize self-awareness and minimize self-deception, which can come in the form of rationalizations about our behavior or unrealistic assessments of our abilities. As physicist Richard Feynman once said, the first principle is that you must not fool yourself, and you are the easiest.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.